In this learning module, we will consider the ways in which Spotfire scatter plots may be used to visualize data, including the ability to examine pairwise correlations, discover data which clusters in two dimensions, and find data which does not conform to those patterns. Spotfire scatter plots are commonly used to examine correlations or relationships between two continuous measures, or to discover common behavior or clustering relative to those two continuous measures. In addition, data points which fall outside of these relationships may be considered outliers, and scatter plots are useful for identifying these outliers. For example, here, there appears to be a correlation between purchases made in the grocery and clothing departments, and this value is a bit of an outlier relative to that trend because of the high amount of grocery purchases. Here, we see that most values fall within a certain range of electronics and furniture purchase amounts. However, there is also a cluster of big spenders on these items. Let's take a look at a demonstration in Spotfire where an analysis file has been configured with several different scatter plot examples. Use Open File in order to navigate to the file with Interpreting Scatter Plots in the title. Click Open and agree to the terms and conditions of use. This example is based upon data collected from a Megamart chain of department stores. Notice that the data table contains a number of continuous measures, which we will examine in a series of scatter plot visualization examples. On this page, the first scatter plot shows a marker for each customer, and the position of the marker indicates the customer's garden and grocery purchases. For example, this customer has a relatively high garden purchase. In fact, it is the second highest in the underlying data table. However, their grocery purchase amount is quite low. This customer's garden purchase amount may be considered an outlier, but their grocery purchase amount is within the range of other customers. This group of customers is clustered with similar garden and grocery purchase amounts, which separate them somewhat from the other customers. And you might notice that marking those customers allows us to see where those customers' markers are positioned relative to their purchase amounts in the shoe and furniture departments in this plot. While we are talking about this plot, notice that reference lines have been drawn in both the horizontal and vertical directions at fixed threshold values in order to divide the plot into quadrants. It appears that none of the customers in our clustered garden and groceries group appears in this quadrant, where shoe purchases are below 200 and furniture purchases are above 600. Let's click where there's nothing in order to unmark the data and move on to the next page. The scatter plot on this page has been configured to relate the number of items purchased and the total amount of purchases for each customer by the position of each marker. Additionally, the color of the markers indicates the major store location in which they shop, the shape of the markers indicates the gender of the customer, and the relative size of the marker indicates the customer's age. For example, this male customer shops in one of the New York area stores and is younger than this female customer who shops in one of our Seattle store locations. Based on the position of each of these markers, the male customer purchases more items from our stores at a lower cost, while the female customer purchases fewer items, which amount to a higher total cost. In addition to the information which is immediately available based upon the marker position, color, shape, and size, filters may be used to isolate customers of interest. For example, limiting data in the plot to view only rural customers who have joined our customer loyalty program within roughly the last 2 years makes it easier to interact with those markers. For additional details, we can mark an outlier and examine the detailed information for that customer in the Details on Demand panel. Let's click where there's nothing in order to clear the marking and reset all filters. Before we leave this page, take note of the fact that the color by property is set to represent a categorical variable. If we proceed to the next page, again, markers are positioned based upon two continuous measures, furniture and electronics purchase amounts. However, there is an additional continuous measure, the number of items purchased, which has been applied to the color by property. Notice that two types of coloring have been applied to this variable. First, a gradient color scale has been set between the values of 0 and 300. A midpoint between those values has been calculated based upon the median number of items purchased. And those values below the median transition from white to blue, while those values above the median transition from blue through purple to red once they are at or above 300. The second color assignment applied uses rules to color the top 100 customers yellow or gold, while the bottom 100 customers, relative to their number of items purchased, are colored black. So you can easily examine any customer's marker and determine the number of items they purchased relative to the definitions provided by this color scheme. And several aspects of this color scheme are configured to be dynamic. For example, take note of the current median value, which has been calculated as 90 items. If we filter out customers in Seattle stores, that calculated value changes from 90 to 95. In addition, take note of this customer, who, in the absence of the customers from the Seattle area stores, is assigned to the bottom 100. Returning the Seattle stores to the visualization lifts that customer out of the bottom 100, even though the very light blue color indicates that their number of items purchased is well below the median. On the next page, there are two items of note. First, in all of the previous scatterplot examples, each marker represented a single customer, in other words, a single row of data. In this scatterplot, the marker by property has been configured to define each marker based on multiple rows of data from the underlying data table. Because each marker represents a group of customer purchases in the clothing and grocery departments, an aggregation was applied. In this case, the sum of clothing and the sum of grocery purchases in each store is represented by the position of each marker. The second thing you may have noticed is that a straight line appears on this plot. This line has been fit to the points in the plot using a linear regression calculation. Select metrics from that calculation are displayed here, the equation for the line, and the R squared or correlation coefficient value squared. Because this fit is calculated based upon the data in the plot, if we filter to isolate only female customers, the line position, equation for the line, and the R squared value will adjust accordingly. Similarly, if we drag and drop store setting upon the final trellis target, each panel will fit the data separately and provide the straight line and associated metrics which are the result of those curve fit calculations. Let's reset the filters and proceed to the final page of this analysis document. These two scatter plots have been configured in order to allow you to examine the density of overlapping data in a scatter plot. The first uses transparency to achieve this goal. Note that individual markers are so transparent that they may even be a bit difficult to see. However, in those areas where many markers are juxtaposed in close proximity, and thereby overlapping to some extent, the cumulative transparency is diminished and results in darker colored areas, or areas of high data density. A more robust solution for examining data density can be configured by binning each of the continuous values into discrete categorical ranges along each axis, and defining the resulting matrix with tiled markers. Each marker within this 25 by 25 matrix is colored based upon the count of rows, in this case customers, which fall within that tile in the matrix. Areas of high data density in this plot are colored purple or red according to the gradient color scheme which has been applied. One advantage to this approach is that the resolution of the matrix is adjustable. Using each of these binning sliders, we could adjust the dimensions of the density matrix to achieve a 10 by 10 grid.